This is a reading from the book Lords of the Seven Rays, written by Mark L. Prophet and Elizabeth Clare Prophet. Published in 1986 by Summit University Press. On the back of the book, it says, Lords of the Seven Rays tells the story of seven mystics who reached for and accomplished the goal of self-transcendence on each of the seven initiatic paths or rays of spiritual growth. The seven rainbow rays of spiritual light correspond to the seven major energy centers or chakras in the body. Each ray has a unique color frequency and quality, and each one represents a different path to self-mastery. You will enter vignettes of the lives of these mystics, some taken from forgotten ages, on legendary continents and civilizations, buried in the sands of time or beneath the seas. By exploring their unique path to spiritual mastery, you will find comfort, inspiration, and invaluable keys for your own life's journey. I'm going to read chapter 6, Lady Master Nada, Lord of the Sixth Ray. Initiation of the Solar Plexus Chakra. Retreat, Saudi Arabia. Vibration, purple and metallic gold, ruby. Gemstone, topaz, ruby, alexandrite, diamond with pearl. Quality, peace, service, brotherhood. Gifts, diverse kinds of tongues, interpretation of tongues. Day of the week, Thursday. The psychology of love. Sometimes in the course of life you meditate, beloved ones, upon the path of the soul's overcoming and the ingredients so precious of the truth that is taught of Christ, and these become to you as a living thing, not inanimate but wholly animated by the Holy Spirit. And sometimes in the richness of the Lord of God and his saints, it escapes one that there are some who have an understanding not so deeply rooted in the foundations of cosmic law. It is then, you see, that the tender vine needs that flame of ministration and service which was and is the path of the Lord Jesus Christ, whose ray I now represent as its choam. Or should I say koam? This sixth ray of love and good cheer is of the heart that understands of necessity the great needs of the pilgrims weary who walk the valleys and the highways, the cities of planet Earth. By the way, I'm not used to English because I'm from the Netherlands, but I'll do my best. Ministering the word, ministering unto the flock, then, is to be a bearer of the cup of Christ and to bring it here and there where the oppressive heat of hell itself would move against the little ones. Just when you think these little ones are safe and sound, having received so much, you realize that the watchful eye of the mother and the father must guard and keep them on the path after which their souls long. How easy it is to be taken away here and there and to lose the sense of discrimination when consciousness moves from truth to a little error, and then one more gross until suddenly it is so gross as to totally engulf the child. So it is with spiritual energies that gradually become psychic through the vanity of the ego. Therefore, the gradations of life are usually identified only when they have reached the extreme. The figure of Christ and Satan seem easily to define, but moving through the marts of the world, we see sparks of light alongside darkness, sometimes in the same individual, and then, of course, the confusion where darkness appears as light, and light is so covered over that you can scarcely recognize it in the dearest friend. Some of you have wondered why I should be both a member of the karmic board and the Lord of the Sixth Ray. It is because of my long experience in pleading before the courts of the world on behalf of souls. As you know, I have been an attorney in many embodiments, reaching far back beyond this civilization. In my learning of the laws that have prevailed in many nations, and in my attempt to find in those laws a point for the justification of the innocent and for the binding of the guilty, I have seen what causes men to go astray, what causes children of the light to be taken in by the dark ones, and how they have put upon earth such a cunning manifestation of treachery. Therefore, I have seen in all of my experiences, and of course you know that the lady never tells her age, for it has been tens of thousands of years that we have worked together for the deliverance of souls, that always the salvation of a living heart is love. Now that love is not necessarily a love that is given, but a love that is already within, a love whereby the child moving towards sonship and godhood can resist temptation because of a greater love. This, therefore, is my plea with you as mothers and fathers and teachers, sponsors of New Age families, concerned citizens dealing with the great problems of crime and the burdens of drugs upon our children. The love that must be instilled, beginning with yourself, is a love so tangible for God in the person of one another, for God in the person of his saints, his angels, the masters, nature, and the simplicity of life itself, that in the presence of such love, the abrogation of the laws of God is altogether unthinkable. A love so full of the penetration of law itself, the love of the law as a witness into truth, the love of the lawgiver as the one who defends the highest interests of his children. I believe that this love instilled within the child must also be a sense of self-worth. For if the child is taught only to love those things outside of himself, he is also taught to have dependency on something that is at a distance. And therefore, the attention is taken away from the self as an individual, the self as worthy, as accountable, as having ability and integrity. One must love oneself not only as the handiwork of God, but as one's own handiwork. And if you do not love what you see or what you have made of yourself, you know that love is the power to consume all that is unreal. Personally, I like people who get along well with themselves, who are happy with themselves, are self-entertained, can laugh at themselves and their own mistakes, and even at their own jokes. I like people who don't take themselves so seriously, and thus dive into a spiral of self-condemnation when they make an error on the way. I guess this is meant that people who take themselves seriously can dive into that spiral. It's not entirely clear. I'll continue. You must realize then that when you feel irritable, when you are burdened with your circumstance, when you are unhappy, alone, in solitude, in total quiet, there is not the inner resolution of the love of the God-free being within. Now all of these things create the propensity to move away from God in the hour of the testing. Do you know that you will punish yourself by way of failing a test merely to prove to yourself and all others that you are not worthy? This is one of the most serious psychological problems of those who live on this planet, the subconscious mechanism to fail as a means of inflicting self-punishment, and by way of proving to everyone that you are as bad as you or they affirm that you are. I will repeat that part. This is one of the most serious psychological problems of those who live on this planet, the subconscious mechanism to fail as a means of inflicting self-punishment, and by way of proving to everyone that you are as bad as you or they affirm that you are. Of course, this momentum can be traced to interactions with parents, for parents always figure in one's heart as a part of oneself and one's self-identity. And therefore, before the child separates out from parent, whatever the parent may do may create the indelible impression of the child being bad or unworthy. And this transferal, of course, stems from the fact that the parents do not love themselves in and as God. And thus we see the entire human generation is a lineage of the propagation of anti-love and anti-self. And the reason, precious hearts, is quite simple. It is because people prefer to love themselves as human beings, and therefore, in an attempt to love that human self, one finds that the human self, because it cannot be perfected, is not necessarily worthy of love, for the soul retains the memory of the perfect image of self who is Christ the Lord, and this alone as worthy of that unconditional love which cannot be fully accorded to the unpredictable, whimsical human self. And this, beloved, is the root of the dilemma of human love, as well as the love-hate patterns which sometimes plague human relationships. And thus, one's moorings must be altered. One must penetrate to the core of life, to the origin of all things, to the descent of the soul from God, to the realization that the compelling force of being is one's divinity. You may not like yourself for your mistakes, for your meanness or gruffness or anger or any of these conditions. Well, we do not expect you to like these things. The angels don't enjoy them. The masters shield their eyes from them. There is only one thing to do with these things, to put them into the sacred fire, and then to affirm their unreality past, present and future. Therefore, we come to the platform of self-forgiveness. Christ in you can forgive you, but you, the soul, must be humble enough to accept that forgiveness and not to continue to affirm in your willfulness that meanness or that sinfulness, almost by a way of a perverted pride or an untoward false humility. I will repeat that part. Therefore, we come to the platform of self-forgiveness. Christ in you can forgive you. But you, the soul, must be humble enough to accept that forgiveness and not to continue to affirm in your willfulness that meanness or that sinfulness, almost by way of a perverted pride or an untoward false humility. Now I reveal to you the tricks that the human mind plays upon itself and upon your soul, by way of limiting the expansion of the divinity within you. And I do this for a purpose, for I come to teach you the way of the sixth ray of Christ and his servants. Why do you think so many people in this world consider themselves not only unworthy to be disciples of Christ, but absolutely unworthy to be the manifestation of Christ himself? Pure and simple it is. They do not like themselves. They do not approve of themselves, and they act unwittingly to use the power that God has given them to reinforce the entire momentum of sin, and condemnation which as a yoke is put upon the souls of God upon earth. And many people, even the spouses of our devotees, have cast themselves in a certain mold of the human consciousness and have said, I am this and I am that and I am this, and therefore I am not worthy to be a serious churchgoer or a follower of God. I will leave that to you because I am what I am. Leave me to be what I am. And all of this is nothing more than a human momentum multiplied by the mass consciousness, multiplied by the media, which has a way of reinforcing everyone's belief in their own humanness and denying anyone's possible hope in their own Christhood. It is as though the entire world were in a deep sleep, accepting this hypnotic spell that has been cast upon it. And yet Christ has come, and he has lived, and he has taught the fulcrum of the path to be one of forgiveness, which can never be sealed, of course, without the forsaking, again and again and again, if necessary, of the wrongness of one's willful ways. Beginning at the beginning, then, let us teach our children, and this includes our soul, for the soul is the child emerging to the divine sonship in your temple. Let us teach our children the reality of love. Let us realize that love, as the intense white fire of God, is that quality which molds and perfects and elevates and disciplines. It is a love that loves so much that it doesn't fear to chastise, to bring into alignment, but always by love. For each and every time the condemnation of the human mind is conveyed, the condemnation of the devils themselves, there is a loss of that love tie. Now, where can you go for the example of just what is the razor's edge? You have only to look at John the Baptist and the Lord Christ to see how they dealt both with the children of light and with the sons of Belial. Recognizing that the love of God may manifest as the most intense fierceness that will ever pass through the heart by way of consuming on contact the very wickedness that is wont to enter into the hearts of those who yet retain this self-condemnation, the danger in the preaching of a sermon such as I give you is the realization that some who don't have the depth of the love of God will take my words as an excuse to be entirely irresponsible concerning their misuse of the laws of God, whereas such love of which I speak, so great within one's being, loves the friend, the brother, the sister enough to say, I must pay back to the last farthing for each and any and all situations that I have caused which have become a burden upon you. I will repeat that again. I must pay back to the last farthing for each and any and all situations that I have caused which have become a burden upon you. And do you know that the saints in their desiring to serve have never been satisfied until they could pay back 10 times what they have wrought as a burden against the body of God upon earth or any individual part thereof? Therefore, my beloved, from my perspective, I see that the lost chord of the teaching of the cosmic Christ and the missing link in the evolution of man from the standpoint of the human to the divine is the truth concerning the nature of love. This is the first part, read by Marian, November 13, 2020. This is a reading from the book Lords of the Seven Rays, written by Mark L. Prophet and Elizabeth Clare Prophet.